You don't need to go to Kathmandu or Timbuktu to have a great adventure. In fact, the greatest adventure of all is right in front of you. You're listening to it and watching it right now. We are taking a journey of great adventure without going anywhere, without moving our bodies at all, just sitting quietly and paying attention. And we are looking at concepts and beliefs at the very root, very core of existence. This is a journey that very few have taken. And even more rarely is it spoken about in public. It is terra incognita, unknown territory. We have mapped and charted every place on this globe, and yet there remains this large area of belief and plausibility that we have not looked at all. And yet that's what we're doing right now. All these videos in this Christ Clarity channel take you on a journey into the most dark, forbidden jungles of the mind, of existence, of the belief systems. And so I am your guide, your adventure guide, through, and we walk along this trail through this incredible environment, and it's the most stupendous adventure of them all. Takes the most courage. It's the most shocking. It's the most amazing. You come across inner deceits that have held you spellbound and mesmerized. You come across taboos. You dare not go any further. And yet I say, come on, walk along the trail. It's no problem. Just like a tour guide going through an area that they know very well. And yet those on the tour are very frightened, saying, my gosh, maybe something terrible will happen to us. I say, no, don't worry about it. So we have available now through these videos literally the most awesome type of trekking. We're trekking through the trails of eons past, where we have laid out the map of deception, map of self-deception, that is keeping spirit mesmerized and spellbound to this idea we call existence, which is an extremely foolish, crazy, silly idea of trying to replace reality with a new reality. That's the endeavor we're engaged in. And it's a fruitless, futile endeavor. And yet somehow we have managed to remain fixated on it. And as we go along in these videos, you find out why. And that's crucial. It's bad news, good news. The bad news is we are using all these sorts of crazy devices to keep us fixated. The good news in seeing this, the jig is up. We say, ah, okay, can't fool me anymore like that. So these videos are for the truly intrepid traveler. It makes all of their journeys look like a Sunday picnic at the park, a local park just down the road there. Because this is territory that is unexplored by most, unknown. It's like the great abyss that the people used to believe the ocean fell off into, a great abyss full of massive great sea monsters, and most were terrified to go out on the ocean. Only a few were able to do it and come back and say, hey folks, not a problem. We We have to be intrepid travelers in this area to see the landscape for what it is, to know what it's all about. And we find out we've used so many silly strategies. For instance, we say, well, if we've been fixated on it for eons, this one idea, there must be a very good reason for us to remain fixated. It must be something valid simply because we've done it for so long. But we need to look at that more closely, and we find out what are the reasons why we've remained fixated. Is it because there are no other ideas, or it's dangerous to let go of it? No, because we've been seduced along with a story that mind has told us about how important it is to remain fixated, that there's some great prize, that we can realize our objective. Many, many, many inducements. In fact, mind's entire purpose in presenting this idea to spirit that spirit chose is to keep spirit fixated for as long as possible. That's it. Mind will make up any story it needs to maintain that fixation. So the truth is, we have been fixated for so long because mind's inventiveness and creativity is so superb. That is why. Not because there's some reason that we should remain fixated, some danger if we don't. That is entirely untrue. There's zero danger to spirit in letting go of this idea and choosing another idea. Everything is perfectly fine. So, mind has captivated us with these promises, false promises, and telling us that everything will be fulfilled in time. And then it turns around and tells us, gee, you've been at this for so long, it must be dangerous to let go of it. You must have some real reason to be afraid. See, it's a double cross there by mind. We see this, and say, okay, I'm on to you. We're on to you, mind. You're very tricky with this, as you need to be, because this idea is so silly, so impossible to experience. Spirit can never become the prime creator. It's impossible. But mind promises that there's a way to do it. If we just hang in there long enough, it will all unfold in time, which is what mind keeps saying. It's a process of evolvement, mind will say. It's a long process, but in the end, wow, you get it all. You get to be prime creator. That's what mind is telling spirit. Spirit's eating this up, saying, okay. I'll stick with it here for a while. And for a while, longer and longer and longer. And the centuries go by and the millenniums go by. Like sand through an hourglass, it just keeps going and going and going. And still, spirit sticks with it. And yet here we are, easily seeing through the whole charade, right here in the midst of these times. Think about that. It's important to note that during the last 50-some-odd years, with everything that's taken place, right in the very midst of that, it's been possible to completely see through the entire charade of mind's story to spirit and realize why spirit is still remaining fixated. It's all been possible. Therefore, it's possible in any epoch, in any era. It's always possible with the grace of the prime creator helping orchestrate the clarity, the clarification that's necessary. Will always be possible. Probably always be very difficult as well. Because mind never sleeps, never stops spinning this web of tapestry of outrageous rationale and false hopes and dreams and schemes. Whatever it takes to keep spirit enthralled with this story, fascinated by it, believing that someday it'll reach the goal of being prime creator. Call this whatever you want to call it. Mind will say, well, maybe this is enlightenment, illumination, ascendancy. It will use any term as long as that clicks into Spirit's hopes. But really, all we need to do is to choose a new idea. That's beyond enlightenment, beyond everything that mind can come up with. Because it will literally bring the seamless peace. Seamlessness itself. Don't even have to call it peace. There's simply no seams, nothing stitched together. An unbroken tapestry. That's beyond minds, that's beyond understanding, beyond conceptual understanding. And of course, it's mind that is presenting this, because mind is eternal. It's part of spirit, created by the prime creator. So it's not mind's fault that it's telling us this crazy story. It's the fault of the idea that spirit chose that's causing mind to present this crazy story. Choose a new idea, mind will present that idea. Choose the idea of not trying to create a new reality, not trying to replace reality with a new one. Let everything just be the way it is. And then mind presents this seamless peacefulness. Nothing constructed about it. No constructivity and no destructivity. And this being the effect of a new idea, mind doesn't have to talk about enlightenment or awakening or self-realization or satori or salvation or ascension or any of those terms. It's beyond all that. It's literally coming from a new idea. So it's not an accomplishment. It's simply a choosing a new idea. That's all that it is. We're not looking for accomplishments here. Or attainments. Forget about attainments. All those attainments are part of mind's story that it's spinning, telling spirit that it can have all these attainments if it just hangs in there and keeps believing, keeps choosing this idea. And of course spirit goes along with mind, because that's the nature of reality, is mind presents experiences for spirit. So spirit is trying to enjoy what mind is presenting, but it's not enjoying it. It gets mad at mind. It says, mind, you're really causing me troubles here. So spirit cannot rebel. Spirit cannot get rid of mind. I hear that so often. And I know we must understand the context of those words, get rid of mind. We have to get rid of the mind. It's usually said in a context, a greater context. So, but it's important to note, we cannot get rid of mind. That's impossible. We shouldn't even try at all. Mind is eternal, just like spirit. It's part of spirit. Mind, idea, and spirit is all one. It's three-part functionality to spirit. So forget about getting rid of mind. That's a dream. That's what mind is telling us now. Telling spirit, spirit, you can get rid of me. You can get rid of mind. That'll make you happy. That is just a waste of time. So just accept everything just the way it is. And accept that you cannot accept the way it is. And accept that you'll never be able to accept the way that it is. Accept that too. Accept that you'll be partially accepting, partially non-accepting, and then trying to blend the two together. All that too. Accept that. See, spirit is trying to somehow become immune to mind. That's wrong. That's a mistake. Because if spirit could do that, then spirit would never be able to experience another idea. Because it's mind that presents the ideas to spirit. So spirit should not try to detach from mind. The most powerful meditation, as far as an attitudinal meditation, would be for spirit to love mind, send out gratitude to mind, appreciation. Just pure appreciation, not for anything that mind has done, but just for mind itself. Because in doing so, spirit is acknowledging its own eternal nature. So if you're ever stuck somewhere in some way, which you certainly will be from time to time, just remember, just turn to gratitude to the mind. Even if you're sick, don't blame the mind for anything, just gratitude. Thank the mind for being the mind. Not for anything in particular that it's sending out or presenting, but for just the beingness of the mind, that mind is part of the beingness. And then just ride that wave for a while. And you can even keep on riding it. Don't judge the mind. Of course, the mind is trying to induce all these attitudes that keep spirit fixated. That's what it has to do with this idea. It just maintains that fixation. That's the only way that this idea can be maintained, is for there to be this fixation with it, based on all sorts of falsities and distortions. And it's the only way. If spirit saw it clearly, it would drop this idea instantly. If spirit saw, I cannot accomplish this. This cannot be accomplished. Mind cannot, has no authority to turn me into prime creator of reality. So it's completely stupid. I'll drop it right now. But see, mind's job is to present ideas. So it cannot, the mind can't drop it for spirit. Mind has to present it. And the only way to present it as an experience with continuity is to spin this web of lies and deceits, false hopes, misdirections, nonstop. So the way to deal with this is, don't judge any of it. Good or bad or ugly doesn't matter. Just purely, abstractly, thank mind, appreciate mind, the beingness of mind, and just marinate in that feeling, that appreciation. Because that is spirit gaining faith in mind. Once again, and by doing so, then spirit will have faith to choose a new idea, knowing that mind will be there to present that new idea perfectly. This is a way out. The only way out of one idea is to choose another one. That's why traditions say there's only one way. That's true. There are many ways to get to the will to choose a new idea, but the actual choosing of a new idea is the only way, the one way to move on to another idea. It has to be a choice. Spirit chooses a new idea. That's the only way to move on from existence, the idea of existence. But we can work on developing the will and the faith to do this. There are many ways to do that. That's why you seem to have many different approaches in the throughout history of spiritual approaches. All of that is working, spirit reassuring itself that everything is okay, that mind is okay, that reality is okay, that its functionality is intact. Everything is perfectly intact, therefore it can choose a new idea. Many ways to work on this reassurance. In fact, everyone will have their own unique way to do this. But there are certainly ways not to do it. And we need to point those out. What won't work? You know, attacking mind doesn't work. Trying to get rid of mind doesn't work. Trying to control mind doesn't work. It's just a trap. Mind will slow down for you if that's what it takes to keep your fixation on this idea. Mind will present you with all sorts of mystical experiences, whatever it takes to keep you fixated on this idea. It's best not to ask anything from mind. Don't try to modify it at all. Just let it function. Let it present this idea in every which way. Just cut through all of that. Just go to straight appreciation for the beingness of mind, independent of anything that it's presenting to us. And that'll give a feeling of wholeness to spirit. And that's advice coming back from the 60s, early 70s. Love everything just the way it is. Love it the way it is. But especially apply that to mind. Because if you don't do that, you're going to be enmeshed in judgment. And that's a horrible confusion. Trying to work with mind to emphasize certain things. Terrible path. Because existence is so tricky. It's constructivity and destructivity as a two-faced dynamic, but it's one dynamic. And the interplay of that, the yin and the yang of that, the way that it plays is so tricky. Never-ending mishmash. You can never get anywhere trying to figure it out because there's nothing to figure out. You cannot separate the good from the bad. It's impossible. It's actually one dynamic. It's like having a coin. You're trying to figure out. You just say, I just want the coin with the heads on it. I don't want the tails on the coin. I'm trying to figure out a way to just have the heads. You don't realize that it's one coin with heads and tails. You can't have a coin with one side to it. Love everything exactly the way that it is, meaning you're not trying to alter anything in the slightest degree. If one can do that, then one becomes aware of mind as it is in its abstract beingness. We're not chasing after any of the modifications or a story that mind is telling. We're just looking directly at mind itself, which is beingness, which is spirit. So we're looking at spirit too. mind is our best friend. It has not betrayed us. And yet, in looking at its story, we can never believe that. And in loving everything just the way it is, that means loving our hatred of the story, or our dislike, or our inability to love it the way it is. We love that also. It means let it be. And we may think, oh, if we just love, let everything be, we'll give free rein to everything. But we're not interested in giving free rein. What we're doing is we're loving everything exactly as it is, not trying to get rid of it, anything. But the activity we're involved in is acceptance, and without trying to change anything. So we're not giving free rein to anything in our activities, because that would be trying to emphasize or change something. We're just trying to sit very still and have an attitude of gratitude. For being able to accept everything without trying to change anything, knowing that this is exactly the way it has to be. This is the story that mind has to present to maintain our fixation. So let's thank mind for maintaining our fixation, because that's what we asked mind to do. So this slightly alters the dynamics of our relationship with mind. It improves it. We have an improved sense of inner cohesiveness. Mind is part of us. It's not rogue. Mind didn't go rogue. Even though it's pretending to be rogue. So allow that, accept that mind pretending to be rogue. Don't have to fix it. Don't have to fix anything that mind is doing. Mind presents all this panorama of brokenness. Everything's dysfunctional. I think we have to fix everything, but it's all a perfect dance of dysfunctionality that mind is presenting. Mind isn't dysfunctional. And so neither are we. And we can dare to say these things, dare to look at this, because others have done so before us. It's all fine, it's all really good. But how quickly the mind gets us to forget the efforts of those who come before us. How easily we become oblivious to it. It's so amazing. I tell you, the most amazing thing on this planet. And here we go, around the bend in our adventure here. The most amazing thing is that as people come into this world, they truly are oblivious to those who have been here before, to a large extent, especially the great ones who have been before. For instance, in my generation, I'm very aware of the very top-notch spiritual beings that were here in the world. And yet, those who are of younger, more recent generations would be completely oblivious to this. It's not even part of any history that they're interested in or aware of at all. It's as if it never happened. That's the ultimate shocker. The sands of time cover all. We really don't know. There could have been some great beings. Beingness could have walked this planet many times, and yet we would forget it. It would become forgotten through disinterest. So the capacity to remain oblivious is amazing. The distraction, as I look at the world, I'm just amazed. It is constantly shocking to me to see people come into this world and fall prey to exactly the same schemes and devices I fell prey to, my generation fell prey to, and yet be oblivious to some of the remedies that were available and that we're aware of. And of course, they will search for their own remedies. However, the same foolishness happens over and over and over. It's mind-boggling. You'd think that generations would learn from previous generations. It just doesn't happen right now on this planet. I believe it used to happen more so. It's very, very important to have access to the wisdom of the elders. Absolutely crucial if you want to have a spiritual culture. Because for sure, there will be beings that are fully awakened, who have chosen a new idea, who have this perfect, effortless, boundless peace and seamlessness to them. And people will have contact with those beings. And they will spread that knowledge and that it's possible here, can be done. And then their children need to be brought up in this awareness, and their children, and their children. And there needs to be this, I try to make as much as possible a seamless awareness of this truth. And so it's passed on. And there's a vibrant awareness of this. However, that is not happening. Today, it's just the opposite. It's the pride is to not believe anything that your parents believed. To make a clean break with the past, as if it doesn't matter, never happened. That this is a new world, this is a new, with a new idea, with new ways of going about things, and there's no need to even focus on anything that happened in the past. Doesn't matter. And so as I move into being an elder, so to speak, going in that direction now, 55, I don't see anybody turning to me and saying, you know, what do you know? Because I know an unbelievable amount because I've paid attention to the past and all the great streams of wisdom from the past. Great beings were here in this world. Unbelievable beings. Like Ramana Maharshi was here. Ananda Maima was here. Those beings were absolutely incredible. They were like vast oases of peace. Unshakable peace. And being aware of that, we know it's possible. But it's all slipping away. No matter what we do, we cannot pass this on to younger generations very well. They're dancing to the beat of their own drummer. So it's an amazing time right now where I believe we have lost touch with our cornerstones. Those great beings are the cornerstones by which we are able to judge all other efforts. Compare. How does it compare? You have to have those touchstones. Extremely important. Otherwise, you can fall prey to foolishness. That mind will trick you into accepting all sorts of foolish substitutes. And you think you're following something great, and you're not. But if you have those touchstones, you can look and say, okay, how does this compare to these touchstones? How does it stack up? Is it something that is moving us away or moving us toward those touchstones? But remove those touchstones and you have a culture that is just in free fall, where any sort of silliness seems to be able to take root, where you have these celebrities who are just incredibly silly. Nobody in their right mind would follow them or pay any attention to them. If you're aware of these touchstones, you're not going to give the time of day to any of those celebrities that are so prevalent in the world today. Well, you'd be civil to them, of course, as a brother and sister, eternal brother and sister, part of spirit, but you don't give any time or interest to their antics, to their foolish pronouncements and directions and attitudes and advice and all that. Worse than useless. Because you have the cornerstones, you can look at Ramana, you can look at Ananda Mai Ma, you can look at these great teachers that have been here and tune into their seriousness, tune into their purpose and realize, ah, this is true purpose. And then the purpose of the celebrities doesn't match up at all, doesn't hold up at all. So it's not worthy to spend time that way. Very simple. These touchstones are incredibly important. Literally enables you to dismiss folly from your life, foolishness. To live a truly purposeful life. That is what is so important. Many, many people have also used Jesus this way. And it's helped them a lot as a touchstone and say, this is the purpose. And let us dismiss anything that does not fit in with that purpose. Maintain a very purposeful, driven life. That's important. Now maybe another touchstone will come at some time to remind us. We have to keep being reminded because we're so good at being disposable, throwing everything away. We throw ourselves away. We throw our lives away. We really don't care about our lives so much. We live in a disposable world where I really feel people don't value the opportunity here that we have. We're willing to dispose of ourselves, of our lives, of everything here. It's all throwaway. It's no big deal. But really, our lives are so incredibly important because we have the opportunity to see through the great deception and free ourselves from the cycle of birth and death. So, we should treat everyone with greatest dignity as if they're engaged in something tremendously important. But we know that most in the world are engaged in tremendously frivolous pursuits. They're wasting their lives, their time, and they're willing to waste yours. They're willing to throw their lives away, they're willing to throw yours away. But if you have these touchstones, you will know that these touchstones viewed us, our lives as being extremely important, and the way we use our time is of utmost importance. And we should be very serious about our lives and use our time wisely, very wisely. Don't give time or attention to that which is will fritter our life away. Maintain focused. Maintain your focus on the task at hand, which is clarification, which is reassurance, which is remembrance. Do not spend your days in frivolous pursuits. You can't buy your way free of the cycles of birth and death. You could only choose a new idea. That's the only way. It's only one way. Many reminders, but only one way. There have been many who've come into the world to remind us this, but there's only one way to do it. That is to choose a new idea. People say that Jesus is the only way. Well, Jesus was a personification of this new idea. He came to show us this new idea and to personify it, because the people of that time were, their orientation, their perspective was such as they needed personification. That's the only way they could get it. That's the only approach that they could accept. Is a personification of the idea. But other people in other places and times don't need personifications. They like more abstract approach. Like for me, I like the abstract approach. Personification is okay, but it's not really a necessity. But it is true that Jesus did personify this new idea. And as such, many have a profound, what would you say, appreciation of that. It's very helpful. And others can go to teachers who've chosen a new idea, but don't personify it and dramatize it like Jesus did. He dramatized and personified it in like a drama, so to speak, on a stage, and acted out many things to give people a dramatic, symbolic acting out of this idea and showing how this idea really works, what it's all about. Very profound and helpful. But there are also other cornerstones who personify the peace of the new idea in different ways. It's not a dramatic crucifixion sort of thing. But it's all good. It's all a reminder that we have to choose a new idea. Jesus engaged the world in a certain way, engaged the idea that we have now of trying to replace reality in a certain way. What he did was he showed us what the idea we have now, what its purpose is, which is to destroy reality. So what did we do? We tried to destroy Jesus, tried to wipe him out, kill him forever, get rid of him. And then he showed us that is the idea we have now. And the new idea of not trying to destroy reality he showed the resurrection that, you see, can't be touched by death, cannot be truly harmed at all, this new idea. So all of that's very helpful. And there are other teachers who abide in this seamless peace beyond understanding and just allow us to feel that. And they don't go through showing us how our purpose is to try and destroy reality. That can be looked at abstractly. That can be seen abstractly. We don't have to act it out and personify it and then act it out. It's not necessary. It can be helpful for some, but it's not necessary for all. I can see perfectly well what the purpose of this idea we chose is. I don't need to act it out in any way. I don't need anyone to be destroyed to know what it is. I can see it abstractly, very clearly, just exactly as it is. Some teachers will just be silent. Ramana Maharshi is very, very silent. Nanda Maimonides too. Just sit there silently. Don't say very much of anything. Don't need to. They're just showing you the bliss, the peace of this new idea. Letting you taste that. Knowing that in the tasting of it and getting that contact high of that, you will move in that direction. That's what teachers do. Some of them give you a contact high. They know that then that'll get you to, that'll motivate you. There are differences among us that in ways that we approach this, in ways we reassure ourselves. There are differences. That's why there are different teachers. And some will say that this is the only way I want to go about it. I don't want to go about it any other way. This is what will work for me. And others will say, well, a variety of approaches works best for me. Or this other approach works best for me. It's all simply reassurance. Whether it's Jesus or this or that teacher or whoever, it's reassurance. Jesus came to reassure us. It's reassurance. And reassurance can take many forms. Each one of us is unique. Basically, it's saying reality is absolutely untouched by dreams of its destruction. Will always be untouched. You can choose a new idea. This new idea will present you with a seamless experience. It'll be absolutely wonderful. Peace beyond understanding. Mind is not crazy. It's flawlessly functioning. All of this is reassurance. Jesus just said, you think you can kill a spirit? You can steer, a spirit can be destroyed. Okay, go ahead and destroy my body. I'll let you do that. And you'll see, I'll raise it up again. Showing that the destruction of the body does not destroy spirit. Body is a symbol. So he said, you want to do it? Go ahead. That's a very confrontational way of going about it. It's not the best way for everybody, I'll tell you that. Some like it, some don't. It's a very shocking thing to do, really. He said, "Don't you want to kill me? Sure, go ahead. Not a problem. I'll show you. I'll raise the body up again, just like that." That's a very stunning thing. Only a certain type of people can gravitate to that. Very kind of warlike, aggressive type of people who really want to show, look, I think I can kill spirit, so I'm going to prove it to you I can. And Jesus called their bluff. He said, okay, go ahead and do it. But if you're not an aggressive, warlike person who wants to kill someone, then you're not going to gravitate toward that. You're not going to confront that in that way. A lot of people are much more, much cleverer. You know, I'm not saying they're better, but they're different. Very subtle attack, subtle destructivity is part of their thing. So they need to look at it in a more subtle way. Many people in history, though, are very warlike. They said, you want to fight? Let's fight. Let's decide this right now. Let's hack each other to pieces. Not a problem. But there are others who are entirely different. opposite of that. They say, let's kill each other with kindness, or with guilt, or something like that. So they need a different approach, different way to be reached. Mind is spun an incredibly vast and complex story, and that spirit has become enmeshed in it in many different ways. And so it sees many different ways to get out of that enmeshment, to be reassured. Many, many different ways. You shouldn't have to try and blend it all together. Try to just find one overarching way that combines all ways, so to speak. The goal is always the same. Choose a new idea. That's often been lost sight of as people are fighting over, well, which way is best to be reassured that it's okay to choose a new idea. They fight over that. Mind gets them to fight about that. It's mind that is causing all this conflict, all this fighting among different sects, about religious wars, all these things that have happened. It's mind that is stirring all this up. So we'll lose sight of the objective, which is choose a new idea, which is the same in all approaches, is exactly the same objective. But mind stirs it up, makes the waters very cloudy for everyone. Mind sets different things off against each other, different approaches. It says, oh, this teacher said it's the only teacher. And they says, no, this other teacher said they're the only one. And then it gets some fighting. It instigates these fights. And then while we're fighting, we forget the goal. We lose sight of it. But if you see through mind's tricks, you won't engage in these battles. It's all the level of personality, it's mind's story. Just wasting time. Everyone's unique. For sure, nobody has exactly the same route to reassurance. Will all differ. Some will have similarities to others. Others will not be so similar. So don't waste any time judging this route or that route. Just take the one that works for you. What is it that reassures you that reality cannot be destroyed, cannot be harmed in any way? The functionality of reality is perfectly intact. Always will be. Everything is more functioning flawlessly. Your functionality is perfect. You can choose a new idea any moment. It'll be presented perfectly to you. You are the sovereign power and capability to choose ideas. You have perfect free will. Every moment is still flawlessly there for you. What is it that reminds you of this? Whatever it is, pay attention to that. Because these are facts we're talking about. Reality is not at the mercy of dreams of its destruction. Not at all. Truth is not at the mercy of lies. Life is not at the mercy of death. And yet this crazy story of mind seems to present that it is somehow at the mercy. That life is at the mercy of death. But the life that we're seeing is just a proxy. It's a facsimile. It's a symbol. It's a made-up life, not a real life. So of course this constructivity, this made-up constructivity, is subjected to destructivity. That's the whole purpose of the mind story, is to try and prove that it's possible to destroy reality. So that we remain fixated on the idea, thinking, we're going to get our proof, and we're going to have our capability to experience what it's like to be prime creator. As soon as we figure out how to destroy reality, we get that power. Then we can start to really experience being prime creator. So we wait, we wait, and we wait, and we see everything dying in front of our eyes, in front of our awareness. Ceaseless arising and ceaseless dying. Constructivity, destructivity, ceaseless. We're aware of that. We're witnessing it all, hoping that it somehow is going to derive from that a power We can derive from that a power to destroy reality, which is impossible. This is all just fantasy. We've just been wasting our time, spending it aimlessly, watching an absurd parade of destructivity, of everything falling down and dying, thinking that this means that we're being empowered. What a waste. We're not being empowered. Spirit cannot be empowered to accomplish the impossible. So whatever way that reminds you of this, take that way. Focus on it. Don't lose sight of the goal, which is to choose a new idea, which is what you, Spirit, must do. Fortunately, you have the perfect capability to do that, because that's how you were created. Okay. We now come to the end of our trek, our long trek through this incredible territory. More stupendous than the Himalayas. More exotic than the rainforests. More wondrous than the South Sea Islands. This is real adventure. It's the adventure of your freedom. You no longer have to be fixated on this one idea to the exclusion of all other ideas. We're getting close to that point where we realize that. So, we end this particular trek, and we will have others to go upon. So we hope to see you again here. And until we do, maintain your focus. Very good. That's it.